and Dr. Chinnappa. So I'll be talking about addressing presbyopia. As you all know that presbyopia is a visual condition which becomes apparent, especially in middle age, and in which loss of elasticity of the crystalline lens of the eye that causes defective accommodation and inability to focus sharply for near vision. So let me come to the what are the principles used for correcting presbyopia. Either you can do for monovision by correcting one eye for distance and other eye for near vision, or you can opt for multifocality as some of the Excimer system does, with creating some rings in the cornea, and bifocality by implanting multifocal or extended range or trifocal intraocular lens, or you can even opt for by doing increased depth of focus like in case of camera inlays, or you can opt for a combined approaches. So let me come to the what are the different procedures available. One on the lens procedure, corneal procedure, scleroceliary complex modification. So coming to the lens procedure, we have got multifocal IOLs, accommodating IOLs, and extended range of vision IOLs. So coming to the corneal procedure, presbyelastic or presbyon or cornea inlays. Scleroceliary complex modification, either with the help of scleral spacing device or laser ace procedure. So multifocal IOLs, three types, refractive, diffractive, combined. Of course, those the patients with a significant amount of astigmatism, you can opt for a toric multifocal IOLs. So toric multifocal IOLs, Dr. Vikram Jain will be talking on that. I'll not be telling anything about this in the end. We'll have a discussion. So trifocal IOL, the added advantage of intermediate vision. Of course, all these IOLs will have a reduced contrast sensitivity. So Dr. Satyamurthy is going to talk about the extended range of vision, how it is going to work. So coming to the just few points about the accommodating IOL, actually it has got a hinge we have to put within the bag. Whenever there is a movement of the vitreous, this hinge moves within the eye, that gives an effect for near vision. But this has been once upon a time very much popular. Now lot of people are not using because of the uncertainty about the near vision, and even as a surgeon wise also it's very very difficult to inject this lens. The chances of complication during the surgery is also quite high. This is the one thing I have noticed. I think probably Dr. Tejas used this phakic IOLs with multifocality. So one of the Indian company comes with phakic IOLs with multifocality, especially myopes, those who are like a crossing after 40, high myopes. So if you just give them the option of phakic IOL, then the patient may not be that happy, because they find that after the correction, I cannot see for near. So they come with the phakic IOLs with the multifocality. And we have been trying for sulcoplex pseudophakic supplementary IOL, where a patient already undergone cataract surgery, pseudophakic, they wants to get rid of their glasses. Even one of the company from Europe, so Rainer, has come with this sulcoplex multifocal IOLs. So corneal inlays, I will not be talking anything about this, because Dr. Tejas is the man who has done a maximum number of cases probably in India. He will be sharing his knowledge. So coming to the scleroceliary complex modification, this is very interesting. Last time I was part of one of the presbyopic session in ECRS, one of friends from UK, actually they put a 4 PMMS segments are implanted after creating a 4 incision with a sclerotome in the quadrant of the scleral surface. So you have to do a 4 incision in the sclera and you have to put these implants. But I was very much scared by seeing those videos. But he had a series of around 500 patients. What he said, that supposed to be lifted and create more space between the ciliary muscle and the crystalline lens, that gives an effect for near vision. Few of my friends, especially in Taiwan, they are doing this procedure called laser ace procedure, where visual light erbium YAG laser that ablate around 600 micro laser spots in the sclera, which presume to free ciliary muscle to contract normally. So this is about the laser ace procedure. So they also got around 500 patient follow-up, but I really don't have any personal experience with this laser ACE procedure as far as the presbyopia is concerned. So coming to the presby LASIK, it's a multifocal LASIK treatment, bispheric treatment that induces a spherical aberration for increasing depth of field. So these are the few problems with presby LASIK. I think few of my friends been doing presby LASIK. Now they converted to presbend, and even senior surgeons like Dr. Sri Ganesh, he himself undergone the presbyon treatment. Once upon a time, he used to do this presby LASIK. But what they say with the presby LASIK, initial compromise on the distance vision. Most of the patient will never be happy for distance vision. Oh, and the patient take longer time for adaptation also, with some amount of even a night vision problem, because this procedure is mainly pupil size dependent. And one more thing what I have seen in this procedure, after 5 to 6 years or even after 7 years, you have to repeat this procedure. You have to take the patient in the refractive OT, you have to lift the flap. Once again, you have to re-enhance the procedure. So that is the reason this presby LASIK become like unpopular in the recent times. So coming to the laser branded vision from presbyon, unique technology from Carl Zeiss Meditech with the help of Excimer system, MEL 80 and MEL 90. It works on the combination of micro mono vision and increased depth of focus. So why we have actually picked this micro mono vision? You have seen in children, brain tend to suppress certain blur from one eye to the other eye. So I will be talking about presbyon in detail after a couple of talks. But just in the end, we will have a discussion about which is the best option. So we need to think, because presbyopia, nobody wants to wear glass after age of 40. So we need to think which is the best option. So we have done different, I put one chart like in comparison with multifocal IOL, corneal inlays, presby LASIK, presbyon. So distance vision, intermediate vision I have taken into account, near vision, night driving problems, contrast sensitivity, adaptation, and about the safety. Let us go back to all these slides in the end of this presentation, then we'll decide, okay, which is the best available option available in India. So I invite all our speakers, Dr. Tejas Shah, you all know that star world in the field of ophthalmology. He'll be talking his vast experience in corneal inlays, and I'll be talking about the laser-branded vision. Dr. Chinnappa will be talking about trifocal IOLs. Dr. Vikram Jain will be talking about how multifocal toric IOL will help. And my friend, senior most ophthalmologist from Karnataka, he has got a vast experience, probably the man who has done highest number of extended range of vision IOL in Karnataka, Dr. Satyamurthy, will be sharing his experience about his IOL of that is extended range of vision IOL. So over to Dr. Tejas Shah. Thank you.
Sorry, I'll take a minute. Very good morning once again. Thank you, Dr. Krishna Prasad. Let me start with some basics. What is presbyopia? Well, it's the inability to focus on near objects due to insufficient accommodative ability. The eye condition in which, while corrected for distance, due to age-related factors, the affected person is unable to see clearly for short distance. In fact, presbyopia can be actually described in so many different ways. That this was a small definition, but there are many other side definitions also. In fact, there are theories also to prove how the presbyopia occurs. And there's a big difference in two schools of thoughts for that also. When does it manifest? Well, it's very peculiar. For emmetropes, it usually manifests around 45 years. Till then, we can actually go ahead and do our near job. For hypermetropes, they need a reading glass as early as 35 or 32 or 38, depending on their hyperopia. And for myopes, who can very well easily accommodate depending on their myopia, and they can even pull away without wearing glasses till the age of 55, if they are minus 2, 2.5 or something like that. So it manifestation definitely happens when the ciliary body stops accommodating, but the requirement is a different number that a patient starts wearing actually starts wearing the glasses. It is unique in many ways. Well, funny, it is a landmark which signals a visual change that you are getting old. Visual for your own optical system and for others to notice. Correct? Everybody now says, oh wow, he or she is more important, is presbyopic. And that's where people do not want to actually know about that. So bringing out a monocle or a bifocal in front of 15 people is now considered an embarrassment, or it's revealing your age, which nobody wants to do that. It's one of the greatest certainties of life. You live longer than a certain age and you are bound to get it. You may not have many other manifestations, but presbyopia is definitely going to happen, even if it's a monovision for you. It is unique because it is progressive with age and makes you literally feel that you are getting old. Ask presbyopes like us. So in summary, it is cumulative, especially for hyperopes. It is controversial. There are two theories. Helmholtz is the one which has been time-tested conventional, and then Dr. Shakar has come with another theory. It is continuous. That is, till we lose three diopters, we keep on, the requirement for spectacle keeps on increasing, and it is inconclusive. Because no proper treatment or no one treatment available for is available. And why should we tackle it? It has been there as long as Adam and Eve, correct? But our needs have changed. Before a few decades, a 45-year-old was not ashamed of carrying a monocle or even a magnifying glass to read. But especially our LASIK patients, who we had done LASIK before, say 15 years, 20 years, and now they are turning presbyopic, they also do not want to wear their glasses. And then there is also another subset of patients. The child might have got a LASIK done, he is glass free, and the parent who accompanies him or her is now around 45-50. Why should I be wearing glasses if my kid is not? So they are also another subset of patients, and that's the reason treating presbyopia has been very, very, very important. We had a huge world report coming out, and where it was categorically mentioned that there is no ideal presbyopic treatment yet, but available options offer hope for spectacle independence. So that is what our aim is. Our aim is never 100% spectacle free. So the inlays for presbyopia, they are implanted in stroma at different depths. Coming back to my topic, that is the inlays. Usually the middle-aged patients, there are flap problems and there are pockets, but these are all the points which we are going to cover. So these are the four different inlays which are right now available in the market. We only have experience with the camera inlay, and that is what we are going to say. I'm going to speak about. Others have not are not even available in the country. So what actually is that camera inlay? I'm just showing you a small animation. This is the camera inlay, right? And this is a contact lens. So you can just have a brief idea of what actually a camera inlay looks like. And these are the instruments which you require to implant the inlay, because it is no longer done with the help of a microcratome. You need a femto laser to create a pocket. Okay, so this is the final camera inlay design, because it has undergone a lot of modifications. What actually does it do? Like KP said, it increases the depth of the focus. Please understand, it does not in any way change the refraction of the cornea. The refractive power of the cornea remains the same. This is an annular disc with an aperture of 1.6 millimeter. I'll elucidate more about why the 1.6 millimeter aperture is designed. Then this is the disc which has fenestrations all around. Why? I will tell you more about it. This is for passing of nutrition. And what does it actually do? Well, it increases the depth of the focus. You might all have come across patients in our cataract practice who have a myotic pupil, correct? And even if you check them, they would be, say, plus 0.5, minus 0.5, but they'll be 6-6 for distance and near. You know, these patients, in fact, pose a problem for us, because a myotic patient pupil does not require glasses, and his friend who does not have a myotic pupil says, why did you operate me and I have glasses, and he doesn't have glasses. But the reason is the triad of small pupil and other mechanisms. So the same function, the same fundamental is here followed by the camera inlay, increasing the depth of focus. Now how is this actually simulated? Well, it was Dr. Jack Holladay who created this small situation in his backyard. Now, if you are a camera buff and if you have a SLR, you would understand this jargon more. But well, just to make it simple, simulation of vision with 4mm pupil. The pupil size is 4mm using an SLR camera, focus set at 7.96 feet with f-stop at 5.6. And if the same situation is created, say in your eye, what you will see is, you will see only three targets out of the 15. Now, you change the SLR camera to the different settings, and that is what it simulates as a 1.6 mm pupil. Then you need to change the setting to f-stop 22. And the moment you change the f-stop 22, the entire range of vision starts becoming clear for you. So this is a way of telling you that why 1.6 mm of aperture was selected in the camera inlay. Right? So this is a chart of depth of focus without correction, and this is with correction. And as you can see, the patient has a jolly good vision across 2.5 diopters. It has undergone a lot of refinement, but this is the final product, and that is, it's a PVDF fluoride material. The thickness is only 5 microns. It started with 25 microns. Now it is only 5 microns thick. It has a diameter of 3.8. This entire diameter is 3.8, and this aperture is 1.6. I explained to you why 1.6. It has got 8,400 fenestrations or holes or whatever you call all around in this ring. This is to allow the nutrition of the cornea to pass. If you'll need one more minute for that. Okay, and this is a small animation of, no, this is a surgery of how actually it is being done. So this is a femto flap pocket being created with the help of a femto laser. And this is the camera inlay which is implanted through this small 5mm window. So there are no flaps, no flap related complications, very stable. The patient is up and going to work on the very next day. And you understand, this is very important because these are the productive patients. They are 45 to 55. They cannot take 10, 15 days leave from their work. And this is the...
So you
the
can market. Continue like can just continue. A couple of minutes.
Yeah. So corneal nutrition. Now you have implanted a foreign body in your stroma, right? And you understand that the stroma and the entire cornea takes away a lot of oxygen and nutrients. These nutrients come from the aqueous humor. So this inlay cannot actually block the nutrition coming from the endothelial side. And that's the reason those fenestrations are put, 8,400 random fenestrations. The whole pattern of the inlay allows proper diffusion of metabolites to support the health of all areas of the corneal epithelium. And these are pseudo-random pattern. It maximizes nutrient flow. And it minimizes visual symptoms. Now the question would come that if there are fenestrations, is this patient going to actually have any glares or halos? No, because these are so small, they're so small that they do not transmit a visually perceptible ray of light, right? It only allows transmission of nutrients. Biocompatibility, it is made up of PVDF. Now this PVDF is the same material which has been used in our IOL haptics for now 25 years, right? So it has been very, very biocompatible. Confocal microscopy has been done, and as you can see, these are the endothelial cells. They look normal. This is post camera inlay. These are the corneal rows, not showing any abnormal changes. And these are the keratocytes. That means there was no inflammatory reaction to this camera inlay. This is how it looks on an entry segment OCT. okay. What are the indications? It can be implanted in four different subset of patients. One is the emmetropes. Somebody who has been spectacle free for the entire life is 0.0 or minus plus 0.5. Now ametropes, it can be also implanted in ametropes, wherein it has to be combined with LASIK, right? Because you need to make that person emetrope, and then only you can implant the camera, because camera does not have any refractive power. It can be done post LASIK. Say if you have done a LASIK of a 25-year-old 20 years back, and now the patient comes back for spectacle correction for presbyopia, you can jolly well go ahead and make a pocket and put the camera implant. And now very important is the monofocal pseudophakes, right? There are a lot of patients who might come to a practice who had a monofocal in their eye, And now the friend has got a multifocal, and so they believe that why should I also not have a multifocal? Well, there are two options. You can exchange the IUL, but I think you would not dare to do that. So what would you do? A rather simpler procedure is implant a camera inlay in a pseudophakic patient. Or for that matter, there are many doctors who feel that why should we implant a multifocal IUL with all its problems? You can go ahead and implant a simple monofocal in both eyes and then implant a camera inlay in the non-dominant eye. I will try to skip all this because these are the different indications. There is no change in mean distance stereoacuity scores between pre-op and 6 months post-inlay implantation. Because this is something different than the monovision, which in monovision you lose entire distance vision. The mean scores for performing near tasks also improved in all categories. This is one of the tests by which you test the success of any presbyopic procedure. Virtually undetectable. In social circumstances, the inlay is virtually undetectable, even in light-colored eyes. We don't have to worry much. We are protected because of our natural brown pigment. But even in Caucasians, it is not very well. It is not kind of as evident as a IQ lens in the eye, the cat's eye reflex and all that stuff. Any procedure is successful or can be said has less complications if it is reversible. If you do a LASIK, it is irreversible. But if you implant a camera inlay, it is absolutely reversible. There has been global inlay removal of 1.3. This has been variable because a lot of research was going in. But patients will return to their baseline refractive target after removal. So at least you're not doing something permanently to the patient for something which he might not like, right? You remove the camera inlay and the patient is back to where he was. Yes, he lost some money, that's it. Optic nerve imaging, normal, nothing different. Gonioscopy, it can be also very well done because this disc is only 3.8 millimeters lying in the deep stroma, 220, 240 microns at the depth of. Retinal examination, well, your retinal colleague might need to slightly modify his way of seeing the periphery, but in a fully dilated pupil, everything is normal. Visual fields, you might say that the visual fields are hampered. Well, not actually. It does not give a scotoma like it should have given. If a cataract develops, well, this is one very pertinent question because these are presbyopic patients, then there are several options. Phacoemulsification and monofocal IOL implantation can be performed with the inlay in situ. It does not hamper your surgical views. I will show you. Inlay can be removed and replaced after monofocal IOL implantation. Well, you can go ahead and implant a multifocal IOL in the same patient and a PCL implanted. IOL power calculations are not at all affected and can be done in the usual way because the central axis is clear. And this is one surgery which has been performed with the inlay inside the eye and monofocal implant implanted. These are some of the slit lamp pictures we have taken on of our own patients. So in summary, it is specifically designed to address presbyopia. Now nearly 40,000 inlays have been implanted. The design provides a complete uninterrupted range of vision. On an average, patients achieve J1 to J2 for uncorrected visual acuity and 20-25 for unaided visual distance equity. Results are sustainable long term and the material is very much biocompatible. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Tejas. I think we'll take up the questions. We're very interesting about the cornea inlays. I think more than 30,000 people in the world already been implanted this. Okay, let us see what and all the other options available, and in the end let us come to a conclusion which is the best available option. As he said that so far, no 100% solution. We'll try to get which is like almost around 99% solution. So I'll be talking about laser blended vision. Correct. This is my financial disclosure. So as I already said that these are the principles to correct presbyopia. So this laser blended vision, it's a combination of micro mono vision and increased depth of focus by using excimer system, either MEL 80 or MEL 90, with a special software CRS Master provided by the company. So what exactly we do in laser blended vision? We make the dominant eye emmetropic and make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 adapters. So the blend zone is the zone where the image from both dominant and non-dominant eye meets up and binocularity retains. So how we increase depth of focus? It is by creating a controlled spherical aberration in both dominant and non-dominant eye. As I already said, we have to make the dominant eye emmetropic, make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopters, along with creating a controlled spherical aberration in both the cornea. So, why we didn't pick this multifocal treatment? As I was telling in my introduction, if you make more rings in the cornea, brain tend to take both images from distant and near vision in the same eye, and it takes longer time to adapt. So, these are the problems with presbyelastic, I already told. You need to do a repeat treatment. There is a definitely change in the contrast sensitivity and loss of distance vision by one line. So, of course, multifocal and extended range of vision and trifocal, I will be talked by my colleagues. But these are the problems we have to tell every patient. That patient will have a night driving problem, patient will have a halos glare, decreased contrast sensitivity. These are the problems you have to explain to the patient. So, this laser blended vision, basically a bilateral treatment, you need to treat both the eyes. So, always binocular vision will be sharper than the monocular vision. So, as far as my friend Professor Dan Reinston, he said that 97% of the patient tolerate this treatment. It is basically on neural summation. So, who are the patient we can do this presbyond? So, any person in presbyopic age, one, myopia with a wide range of power up to 8.5 diopters depending upon the Pachy value. Hypermetropia, you can do up to 4.5, up to 5 diopters. Even you can do it in the patient, those are emmetropic. Astigmatism up to 3.5, up to 4 diopters you can do this treatment. But make sure that patient doesn't have cataract. So let me come to the technique. Mainly is refraction. So hypermetropic patient, even though they are at the age of 37, 38, or even after 40 years also, I do a cycloplegic refraction. That is very, very important. In spite of I am having many optometrists working in my clinic, still doing this test, especially dominant eye testing, I do it myself. If you make some mistake in finding patient's dominant eye, you are in a soup. So you need to find out yourself, being a doctor, which is the patient's dominant eye. Once you know that, okay, suppose for example my dominant eye is right eye, so you have already seen that, okay, right eye is dominant, then you add 1.5 diopters to the non-dominant eye, then ask the patient to read for near vision. One eye for distance already you have corrected. Once you know that it is like which is the dominant eye, if the patient is having refract error, you correct it for distance, both dominant and non-dominant eye. Tell him to see for distance, then tell him to see for near. For non-dominant eye, you add 1.5 diopters. Then patient will start reading for near vision. With the same correction on, you tell him to read for distance. So when you tell the patient, when they start reading for distance, most of the patients say that I don't have any problem, I could be able to read even last line also. These are the patients do really well after the treatment. But some percentage of the patient, when you do this micro mono vision testing, immediately they say, doctor, you have done something to my eye, I am having slight cross blur for the distance. In such cases, you need to repeat this test, micro mono vision. After doing 2 to 3 times, still if you think that patient for distance vision complaining of cross blur, these are the patients you should not pick them for this particular treatment. Then apart from that, routine LASIK examination, if you do all this testing, you need to enter in the CRS master. It itself will plan how much spherical abrasion, it will induce in the cornea. Straight away with the pen dry, you have to go and load into the machine. So how is good presbyopic treatment going to affect my practice? Who are the patient actually, because of this presbyon, because I started probably early in the overall India, I think we have done the maximum number of this presbyon surgery. Whoever we convince, especially patients already undergone, parents will come along with the LASIK patient. Next word, parents will ask, doctor, you have made my daughter spectacle free. What about my situation? I am a little bit fed up with wearing this near vision glasses. Do I have any solution in the same LASIK platform? Then these are the patients actually we can convince them for this particular treatment. And normally I convince them after 36 or 38 years, as Dr. Tejas said that, even presbyopia can even start from even 36 years of age. And nowadays you know that most of us very much wants to be used with the mobile, even with the laptop, computer. They need to have this intermediate vision. So you can, widest range of power you can convince the patient for this treatment. And this treatment is mainly pupil independent. So, and even we have started doing the patient already undergone the cataract surgery. We have done this particular treatment in many patients. So coming to the software, actually, for that exact, that add 1.5 adapters will be there in the software. But if the patient is around little bit young, around 37, 38 years, you check whether they are already developing presbyopia. So around 38, some of the patient, when you put a plus one, they said, no, now my near vision is very much clear. So then we can convince them. But what I do, see, plus from 1.5, I reduce to 1.25. Because along with 1.25, there is some amount of spherical aberration is also going to induce in the cornea. So it gives an effect of almost around plus 2 to 2.25 near add effect. If you put it 1.5, it gives almost 2.5 effect for near add. So I slightly reduce for younger patient around 38 to 40 years. So nowadays, even they have come with a new software, ability to include functional age, greater flexibility of optical zone while planning for treatment, ability to consider pre-op spherical aberration of the eye, you can do a customization. So this is about the software. So just small video. So see, depending upon the patient effort ability, you can opt for either microkeratome flap or femto flap. But you need to be a bit careful when you're treating hypermetropic patient. You need to cover the hinge, because sometimes laser spots tend to hit this margin. Then in the end, you may land with some amount of astigmatism. Usual LASIK treatment, there is not much difference in that. So these are our results. Actually, 200 patients came for 6 months or more follow-up. You can see here, binocular vision will be... sharper than the monocular vision. And none of the eyes lost more than half a Snellen's line of vision when compared to pre-op corrected distance visual acuity. So whatever the patient had vision, pre-op distance visual acuity, the patients are retaining that same vision as far as the distance vision is concerned. So coming to the majority of the patient maintain the functional stereo acuity and no loss of contrast sensitivity in these patients. So these are the advantage, not depend upon the pupil size, very, very important. We can do a wide range of power in hypermetropia and even in myopia. Even patient with astigmatism also, you can do this treatment. All my patient had a very good intermediate and near vision. This is the one thing I noticed in all my patient. No significant night vision problem and contrast sensitivity changes. Even nowadays, we started with the patient coming to us with the presbyon. Doctor, what will you do? Those who have got a very thin cornea. What we did for dominant eye, we did a wavefront optimized treatment, and for non-dominant eye, we induced this presbyon software, and all our patients are doing really satisfactory vision. We tell them, you may take around 1 month for getting back your distant vision very clear, but after 1 month, they are doing really well. Even for few patients, we did for both the eye this presbyon software. We are insisted the patient that your distance vision may be like a little bit, take up to 3 months to get it proper. But after 3 months, patients are doing really well. So probably, as far as I know, this is the best and safest presbyopic treatment available till date. So I invite now Dr. Chinnappa, who will be talking about how trifocal IOLs is going to help you to get rid of presbyopia.
Good morning, everybody. So now that we are done with cornea-based treatments for presbyopia, now coming to intraocular lens-based treatment for presbyopia. In this, we have to accept the fact that a major chunk of our patients who come for presbyopia treatment have already developed some amount of cataract, and for those patients, cornea-based treatment could have some amount of shortcomings. So I'll be talking basically about the trifocal IOLs. Mainly, there are a few trifocal IOLs which are there in the market this day. But in India, we have the biggest players are the Atilisa Tri from Carl Zeiss, and then a Tridif, which is an Indian company called Intraocular Care. I have no financial interest in either of them. The point of why trifocal over multifocal comes up is because intermediate vision is unaddressed in multifocal IOLs. What happens is ends up having to make annoying modifications to lifestyles in professions like drivers, computer professions, painters, etc. So, like everybody is talking today that cataract surgery has gone on to become a refractive surgery, and everybody expects to get back to their youthful eye vision. And this is where trifocal IOL come to play. It is based on the same the multifocal IOL platform, which has already been in use for many years now. So the stability of the IOL and the design of the IOL won't change much. It is the optic which changes. Here what happens is the near addition, there is a near addition of 3.3 and an intermediate addition of 1.66. So functionally what happens on the spectacle plane, if you start to think, they get around 2.45 for near and about 0.75 for intermediate vision. What it makes is it significantly improves the intermediate vision without much compromise on near or far vision. Yes, because of more rings and more steps on the optic, definitely the chances of glare are a little more than usual, the usual multifocal. But then functional abilities of the patient to carry on different activities are unhindered in trifocal IOLs. Coming to light energy transmittance, it has a very highly efficient optic design, about 85.7% transmittance, because we can never have 100% transmittance when we have two focal points. Herein we have three focal points. So what happens is the amount of light that enters the eye through the lens is already compromised, but then it is not as much as to be significant. So here you can see this graph, which shows that although there are different amounts of light intensity for different distances, the amount or the graph remains quite flat in pupil sizes. So it doesn't really matter what the pupil size is. Now, this is a comparative optical bench measurement using an in situ model to compare the intermediate vision quality for three different lenses. That is, first one is the Atilisa tree that I'm talking about, and then an apodized bifocal and a convolutional design. So here you can see that both in the 3 mm pupil and in the 4.5 mm pupil, the intermediate vision is quite clear, and compared to the other lenses is much better than the other two lenses. Coming to poor lighting conditions. In scotopic vision, what happens is whatever increased depth of focus we're talking about, in scotopic light conditions, they are always compromised. So, I mean, then the question comes, if we have light transmittance differences in trifocal and in extended range of vision IOL, how does it compare? So, if we go to that, I mean, that the extended range of vision will be spoken about by Dr. Satyamurthy later. But then, with the comparison with other multifocal IOLs, definitely the trifocal IOL fares better in poor lighting conditions. The intermediate defocus curve, you can see here, that I mean, it is quite flat. I mean, having a flat defocus curve in a multifocal itself is a challenge. So if we have a such a flat defocus curve for intermediate vision, that is where the uniqueness of this IOL comes in. So this is for distance. The same IOL checked for distance, intermediate and near. Yes, definitely the far distance is quite clear and the near distance is clearer than intermediate. But then here we are looking at having no intermediate vision or some intermediate vision. So definitely you can say that as compared to a multifocal, the intermediate vision is far, far better in a trifocal IOL. And this particular trifocal IOL that I have been talking about, the only one that I have experience with, the AT-LISA tree from Carl Zeiss, they have some other additional features like PCO protection and then because of the PCO protection, it makes it more better than, although it is an hydrophilic IOL, it makes it better than hydrophobic in some conditions. So now coming to the few studies that have been done on the AT-LISA tree, about 108 eyes of 64 patients were studied. And you can see that this is the preoperative data that what we have, and the spherical equivalence was about minus 0.12 plus or minus 3.06. And the uncorrected distance vision acuity and the best corrected distance vision acuity doesn't change much. And the spherical equivalents, as you can see, in different months of follow-up are nearly the same. They are very comparable. And biometry becomes very key. So, implanting a lens like this, which does fall under the premium category, getting your biometry right is of utmost importance. So, I wouldn't press on much on that. And the newer thing about this trifocal IOL is now they come with the astigmatism correction as well. It's called the trifocal toric. So even these have been studied extensively, mainly in Europe, especially by some French and German surgeons. And they have shown that the stability of this IOL is very comparable to any other design. Because initially, when you see a four-haptic or a plate-haptic design, the rotational stability was always questioned. But with these studies, those have been put to rest and said that, it is way better than, what we have already seen. And it comes in a preloaded platform, so that makes it a no-touch and much easier and shorter surgical time. That is an added advantage for these lenses. And then the MICS as well. This is just a small animation as to how these lenses come. It's actually a hydrophilic IOL. So what we just have to do is pull it out from the hydrophilic the pack that it comes in, and then it goes into the hinge on the injector like that, and then once the catch comes out, you just have to put, that's the lens in the cartridge, which is already pre-filled. You just have to clutch the cartridge, put some IOL behind for some smooth delivery, and then we're good to go. And then the conclusion is, AT-LISA tree and AC-LISA tree toric provide effective and comfortable distance intermediate visual acuity. These lenses are diffractive multifocals and present a penalization of contrast up to 30%. That is something that we have to accept. That contrast sensitivity drop will be there, but then that is the compromise. That is what we pay for good intermediate vision, because our lifestyles with computers and tablets and everything comes at intermediate vision distance, and that is the compromise we do, or the price we pay by losing some amount of contrast. And then definitely, like I already spoke about, glare is an issue. It cannot completely be ruled out, but then that is again a price we pay for good intermediate vision. So due to these features, trifocal and trifocal provide higher spectacle independence than any other option that is available at present for cataractous presbyopic patients. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chinnappa. Well, I think it looks quite promising about trifocal IOLs, but for Indian scenario, actually, because of the price factor, I think not every patient is affordable this trifocal IOLs. I think both eye together might be costing around 2 lakhs rupees, which is a huge money for any Indian patient. So Dr. Vikram Jain will be talking about, with the help of multifocal only, still we could be able to get a good results for near vision. So what to do?
A small comment. A lot of people felt that this is a plate haptic IUL, the trifocal, but this is not a plate haptic.
It's a four haptic.
Four haptic. There is a big difference between a plate haptic IULs which were there some decades back, and this is a four haptic IUL. So do not try to be under the impression that these are plate haptic lenses which fall when a YAG capsulotomy is done. That was one myth that which really needs to be addressed.
And also the question of rotational stability came in because of the plate haptics. Yeah. But then the four haptic actually takes care of that as well. So toric works quite well.
Yeah. Over to Dr. Vikram.
Thank you. So today our patients want to see better than they used to before they had the cataract also. Our earlier patients would want to see better than they used to see when they developed a cataract. Today's patients want to see even better, like what they had, what vision they had even before they developed a cataract. They want to better it also. They expect that from us. They expect spectacle independency. They don't want to wear spectacles. They are tired of wearing their presbyopic spectacles. Once they go for the surgery, they don't want this. And therefore, the option of multifocals appeals to a lot of people despite its disadvantages. We also have evolved from doing just a plain phaco with a monofocal to giving some astigmatic correction in the form of toric IOLs and reducing the spectacle dependency by using multifocals or trifocals, bifocals or trifocals, and a combination of both, that is the toric multifocals or the toric trifocals. IOLs have been evolving in terms of their materials or designs as well as their optical properties, that is the multifocal IOLs and the toric IOLs. This is all just to bridge the gap between the natural lens and the implanted lens. An ideal natural lens will accommodate throughout life. In case there is no refractive error, the patient will have clear vision at all distances when he accommodates near as well as distance if he doesn't have a refractive error, and clear vision in all lighting conditions with great contrast sensitivity. A few of these will not be there when we use a traditional monofocal, that is, he won't have any accommodation. If he had astigmatism preoperatively, that may not be corrected with the traditional monofocal. But with the use of toric IOLs, multifocal IOLs, or toric multifocal, toric trifocal IOLs, these can be overcome, but at a slight cost of reduced contrast. Multifocal IOLs can either be refractive IOLs or diffractive IOLs. In refractive IOLs, the power of the IOL comes from the different refractive zones, which provide different focal points for distance and near. As shown in this picture, you have different focal points. Whereas the principle of diffraction literally means that the light is bent by the means of certain steps or discontinuities, and the basic refractive power is produced by the anterior surface, and these steps are there on the posterior surface. The diffractive steps are there on the posterior surface of the lens, which provides again different focal points. If you see this, you can see that the focal points are much sharper when compared to the refractive IOLs, and therefore the glare and the halos are better with diffractive IOLs when compared to the refractive IOLs. The loss of contrast sensitivity, a slight loss, is there in both refractive and diffractive IOLs. The glare and the halos improve whenever the bilateral implantation is done because of the summation. The patient perceives the better images from both the eyes, and therefore the glares are then not very much noticed by the patient. That's why we always insist that get the second eye done first. However, astigmatism is always a problem even with the monofocal. Patients with the residual astigmatism are never happy because even with the monofocal, they do not have that post-op day one, first week wow effect is not there whenever there is a residual astigmatism. The quality of vision is always lesser, and the patient is disappointed despite you giving him better uncorrected distance visual acuity than he has had his entire life. He would expect much more because some neighbor would have told him that I never need glass, I can see everything even for distance. But he has astigmatism and we put a monofocal, he is never going to be happy. And therefore, toric IOLs are important in such patients. in multifocal, especially this astigmatism has to be corrected, because this astigmatism itself will cause a slight loss of contrast sensitivity, which will be compounded by the multifocal, and therefore a patient with a residual astigmatism and you put a multifocal, he's definitely not going to be happy. Forget the halos, even his distance vision would be compromised and he would have had a lot of expectations. And whenever we put a multifocal, we need the least possible blurred image, and therefore we should also correct whatever astigmatism is there. So in a patient with minimal astigmatism, if you put a basic IOL, he's happy because he has to use only reading glasses. To make him even more happy, you put a multifocal IOL. In a patient with significant astigmatism, even if you put a standard monofocal, he's never going to be happy because for distance as well as near, he has to use glasses. If he doesn't want to wear glasses for distance, you can put a toric IOL, and therefore he'll require glasses only for reading. If you put a multifocal toric, he's going to be the happiest patient because all his life he has never had spectacle independence, and now he has spectacle independence for most of his activities, if not all. For a toric multifocal, we need excellent rotational stability. As Dr. Chinnappa and Dr. Tejas has already mentioned, this platform, that is the 4 haptic design, by Zeiss produces excellent rotational stability, and also it's a bitoric design. The toricity is divided on the anterior and the posterior surface, and therefore up to 12 adapters of cylindrical power can be provided in these lenses. The 4 haptic lens, as we've already discussed, has got excellent rotational stability. One more point is very stable centration, which is very important with these multifocal lenses, less so with diffractive when compared to the refractive lenses, but still whatever centration you get, the optimum centration is very important with these lenses. And also the very good point about this is it can be rotated in any direction when you are doing your final alignment after you remove your visco. Whereas with other lenses, you can rotate it only in one direction. Suppose it is rotated a little more, you'll have to rotate the lens by around 170 degrees again to get back to that final alignment. Whereas with this lens, you can rotate it in both directions, and therefore you can fine tune it very fast. With the toric IOLs, they're extremely forgiving for small degrees of misalignment, but with toric multifocals, you need very good alignment for the ultimate clarity with the multifocal. With toric multifocals, calculation of the residual power is very important. Now, this calculator, if you see here, is giving you the ideal lens that is to be implanted, 21 with 3.5 cylinder in the lens plane. However, there is a residual power spherical equivalent of 0.24 because of a cylinder of 0.3. Now, this is not desirable. This calculator, this is the proprietary calculator by Zeiss itself, the ZCal calculator. You have this advanced option, and then when we use the advanced option, you can increase or decrease both variables, that is the sphere as well as the cylinder. Now, if you see, the calculator power was 21 with 3.5. I personally calculate these powers myself rather than just giving the values, the K values and the axial length values to the company and letting them do that, because I would like to look at what spherical equivalent is remaining, what a cylinder is remaining, and fine-tune it. Now here, if we decrease the sphere and increase, this comes by trial and error. You try all options. Now here I have decreased the sphere by 0.5 and increased the cylinder by 0.5. And here my residual spherical equivalent is only 0.05. The cylinder, which was 0.3, becomes 0.07. And definitely this, the same patient with the same, in comparison with the standard lens that the calculator has given you, if you implant this lens, this power, where you have calculated it yourself, you have fine-tuned it yourself, this patient is going to be much happier. Always preoperatively try to repeat your measurements multiple times, especially if you are using an AR machine which can give different K values each time. Repeat it around 3 or 4 times and try to see what matches the most. You should use those. Do a corneal topography to rule out any corneal problems which might be the cause for the major degree of astigmatism. Finer problems in diabetes, especially like this, which you may not pick up if there is a posterior subcapsular cataract, which you will pick up with an OCT, a good OCT, and you should avoid multifocals in such patients to keep them happy, because they're going to be having a lot of expectation when they are, because we would tell them clear distance, clear vision for distance as well as near. His expectations are definitely going to be higher. If we do all these tests, then definitely we can avoid a multifocal in such patients and keep them happy postoperatively. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikram. In the end, we'll have a sufficient time for discussion with each technique. So Dr. Satyamurthy will be talking about his experience with extended range of vision IOLs. Over to Dr. Satyamurthy. He's a senior ophthalmologist from Karnataka, from MM Joshi Eye Hospital, Dharwad.
I would like to congratulate Dr. Krishna Prasad for joining the national team as a member scientific committee and wish him all the best. And I'm thankful to him for giving me this opportunity to be here in this update on the options for presbyopic correction. So we have heard all those options, like a multifocal IOLs, inlays, then accommodative laser corrections and all that. Now, I would like to just see multifocal IOLs. Already, Dr. Krishna Prasad has mentioned, the problems are like a lot of glare and halos, because of which I think the practice has come down to almost 10%. Maybe some people are doing 20%. Because many patients, they're not happy. They come back and there's always a need for either lens exchange. That's not end of the world, but still, for the patient, it's a second surgery. Second thing is, patient may take a second opinion. So these are the problems that we're having. And accommodative IOLs, they have their own set of problems, and not many people are talking about these things now, because over a period of time, the range of accommodation comes down. And then we have heard about the laser vision correction. This is an expensive option, no doubt, but it also has got its own problems, like the contrast sensitivity is reduced. In the multifocality that is created on the cornea over a period of time, there can be regression, there can be recurrence of the presbyopia may not be fully corrected to the patient's satisfaction. Now, along with all these problems, this chromatic aberration is also one thing which can reduce the image quality, thereby the patient's vision may not be adequate. So other options we have seen, one is the trifocal IOLs. Dr. Chinnappa has mentioned. It's a very good option. It gives for intermediate vision also, but at the same time, the glare and halos still haunts the surgeon as well as the patient. So the next IOL that is available is this extended range of vision lenses. Let's see how it works. We have seen that diffractive design, what exactly it does is, it divides the light that comes into one for the near focus, other for the distant focus. They have modified this design, this is HLED design, where there are multiple foci which are just so close to each other that the whole thing becomes one continuous focus of vision. This is what is they call as extended range of vision. So this has got two complementary technologies. One thing is it elongates the focus, as I discussed. Second thing is the chromatic aberration is minimized. How exactly this happens? In chromatic aberration, what exactly happens is the light is the blue color, it gets focused in front of the retina, and red gets focused behind the retina. That still it has not come to focus, whereas the green light is focused on the retina. So this forms a blur circle on the retina, thereby the image quality suffers. So this chromatic aberration, if it is more beyond a certain point, probably patient may start seeing images like this. So what exactly it does is, it brings down these foci closer to each other. All of them may not form on the retina, but still, the focus, blue, green, red, they come very close to each other so that the blur circle on the retina is minimized. So this is what is called as achromatic technology. So now this is on an aspheric platform. So thereby it takes care of the positive spherical aberration of cornea. It takes care of chromatic aberration. At the same time, it extends the focus. So this is the lens which can give a better quality vision over a long range of focus. So now there's something called as Abbe value or Abbe number. What exactly it is? This is the measure of the characteristic of the optical material for chromatic dispersion. normally all those optical materials that are available today, the range is from 35 to 60. As the number is higher, it goes higher, the chromatic dispersion is less. So all those lenses that we have today in the market, most of them, I am not mentioning all of them here, as you see here, the Abbe number is like this, ranges from 37 to 47. This acrylic from AMO has got highest 55. They have no financial interest in this particular material as such. So as a result, what we have here is, we have a lens on the aspheric platform, which takes care of the positive spherical aberration. And this has got a negative spherical aberration of over minus 0.27. And then it has got HLF design, which is a modified diffractive design, which elongates the focus. At the same time, the chromatic aberration is also taken care of. Thereby, the image quality is maintained. So normally, following diffraction, there will be slight drop in the image quality as well as the contrast. But that is corrected by or nullified by this improvement of the image by aspheric as well as achromatic technologies. So as a result, the distant vision of this is similar to monofocal aspheric IOLs. The intermediate vision is very good at, say, 1.5 meters, say 75 centimeters. Near vision is good at 40 centimeters. It may not be as good as a multifocal IOL, but definitely it is better than a monofocal lens. If you see here, the modular transfer function, the graph, so this, what you're seeing on top, is the one with achromatic technology and the ERV lens. So the modular transfer function is quite good here. That means the image that is formed on the retina is very good. There are a lot of studies. One study conducted in New Zealand says that sustained the mean visual acuity of 2020 at 1.5 meters of defocus, and then full range of functional vision at 2.5 meters, then the incidence of halo and glare are comparable to a monofocal aspheric IOL. There is a two-line improvement in the mean intermediate and the near vision acuity in case of when both the things are used. So there was Dr. Krishna Basad did mention, he spoke at length about the monovision. In fact, that is the thing which can give a satisfactory vision to the patient without many problems like the glare and halos. Here also, because here the near vision starts from 40 centimeters onwards, but patients, they want to really take it little closer. So what we can do is, dominant eye, you adjust for distance. Non-dominant eye, you can adjust, you can make him myo by about 0.5 to 0.75 diopters. As you see here, the binocular vision, so this graph that you're seeing is with a minus 0.5 diopter of monovision. So this is quite acceptable. It is closer to 2020. At the same time, the near vision is also good. The 0.75 is also good. Anything beyond that, probably patient may not appreciate. The binocularity may get affected. Then the other best feature of this particular lens is the tolerance to the refractive errors. I have experience only in the pseudophakic eyes. I have not done this as a primary procedure for any of the presbyopes. So here, even if there is an error of about 0.5 diopters as a plus or minus, or a cylinder up to 1 diopter, still the patients do well, they don't complain. So that is one thing which has been observed. Now they have introduced this toric lens also to correct the astigmatism. So what do we have here? We have an aspheric platform. We have a modified diffractive design, that is HLA design, which what exactly it does is it takes care of the chromatic aberrations, gives the achromatic technology, and it gives the extended depth of focus or extended range of vision, we call, and then the distance vision is similar to monofocal lenses. This is not called as a multifocal IOL. This is something similar to multifocal IOL, but it is basically a monofocal IOL with an extended range of vision. And the near vision is definitely better than monofocal IOLs. The glare and halos are comparable to monofocal aspheric IOLs. Then there's a good contrast sensitivity because you have taken care of the spherical aberration also. And then the dysphotopsias are minimized because of the lens design. And then micro monovision is the one which helps the patient to see, to have a good near vision without the spectacles, so spectacle free. And now the toric lens is also available. So in conclusion, I would like to say extended range of vision IOL is the first and only presbyopia correcting extended range of vision IOL. It delivers continuous full range of high quality vision with reduced incidence of halos and glare, which are comparable to monofocal IOLs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Satyamurthy. I think before now I come to the discussion part, which is the best available option. Dr. Tejas is going to just show a half a minute video on it's just one small experience with phakic,
which I believe we should not be doing. And then what is the option? We can go ahead and implant a presbyopic phakic IOL. Correct?
Which is the best available option? So I think we had Dr. Tejas spoke about corneal inlays. I spoke on presbyond, and Dr. Chinnappa spoke about the Chinnappa and Vikram together spoke about the multifocal IOL. So coming to the distance vision, I think with multifocal IOLs also I have got a fair amount of good distance vision. But intermediate vision is good with the trifocal, but not with the multifocal, but extended range of vision definitely will have a good intermediate vision. About the near vision with the multifocal IOLs will be good. Night driving problems, of course, so with all this multifocal or trifocal IOLs will be there. I need to ask Dr. Satyamurthy in the end of this discussion, how much is the problem with the night driving with the extended range of vision IOLs? And definitely all these multifocal IOLs or trifocal, reduction in the contrast sensitivity, adaptation is also take some time, and safety is fair. So coming to the corneal inlays, very much promising unit to implant, as Dr. Tejas said, that non-dominant eye, distance vision is pretty good, intermediate also very good. Night driving problem will have some amount of night driving problem with reduced contrast sensitivity, but good adaptation you need to see here, and safety wise also fair. So coming to the presbyelastic, actually just I put as a comparison, that is also distance vision good, intermediate also very good, but night driving problem is also there, reduced slow and fair. So coming to the my technique, there is presbyond, you can see good distance vision, very good intermediate vision, near vision good to fair also, no night driving problem. This thing you need to note, that especially for younger patient, contrast sensitivity no changes, of course adaptation is also fast, and safety is also good. So let me start with the few questions to Dr. Tejas Shah. How much by implanting corneal inlays, how much presbyopic effect I will have in as far as the dioptric power is concerned?
Okay, so the aperture which I talked about, 1.6 mm, it gives an extended range of vision of about 2 to 2.25 diopters of vision. So it is okay over a period of 45 to 55 and forever. Because like I said, it does not work on the principles of changing the refraction. It only works on changing the depth of focus. So yeah, it is good. It is, once you implant it, it's good for all the ages. That's the biggest advantage. You don't need to keep on changing the disc or the annular inlay.
Okay. So second one, you're talking about if the patient develop a cataract.
Yeah.
Suppose like, please tell us that if the patient is already having corneal inlays in their eye, how you are going to check for the IOL power calculation, whether is there any some special software available in IOL Master, or you need to straight away go ahead and calculate?
No issues at all. There are two, three things which we can do. Say, whenever we are doing embarking on a new procedure, what we do is we do a comprehensive checkup. So the patient's IOL power is already checked before. Second thing is we have checked the IOL power after implanting the inlay. No change, because the central visual axis is clear. This is the part which measures the ultrasound rays goes and measures, or the optical rays, whatever happens. And third is, it is very easy to do the surgery with an inlay inside. I showed that in one of the pictures. Or if you are planning for a multifocal IOL, you just remove the inlay and then go ahead and do a cataract surgery. But I would rather say that keep the inlay and implant a monofocal IOL. So
what
all
monofocal IOL? Whether you have to put a aspheric or non-aspheric IOL?
That again is a question, not much experience, because we haven't actually done the surgery. Only one surgery has been done by a doctor in US. So I don't think the inlay will change your decision. It will be the aberrations which will make you change, because there is no change in the corneal refract power.
Okay.
No change in the corneal curvature. The disc is only 5 microns. So I think it will be decided so by your...
Yeah. We have to put a monofocal IOL. After putting the monofocal IOL, that means still patient will have that near vision effect in the cornea.
Exactly, because the mechanism is different. It is like symphony is extending the range of vision. This is extending the range of depth of focus, which is what actually symphony does, but in a different way.
So adding on to that, so even with the press beyond also, those who are undergone this press beyond surgery, even patient develops the cataract, you need to put a aspheric monofocal IOL in the eye. So after putting the aspheric monofocal intraocular lens, still the effect of near vision remains in the cornea, even after the press beyond surgery also. Now coming to the one interesting point, of course, all talking about how exactly increase depth of focus. So straight away, I'll go my question with Dr. Satyamurthy. I think he has got a vast experience with the extended range of IOLs. But people say that very good lens for distance vision, but as far as the near vision is concerned, not so happy. Do you do any adjustment when you're doing biometry for get that exact N5U?
No, as I mentioned, always plan for monovision and the binocular surgery. Not on the same day, but at least inform the patient like how we do for multifocal IOLs. One eye, definitely, you aim at ametropia for distance. And the other eye, monovision, say 0.5 to 0.7.
So you need to do, that's what the people say that.
Yeah.
Other eye, at least you have to do a monovision with the 0.5 extra IOL you have to put. Otherwise, your near vision will be hampered. And is there any of your patient having a night vision problem?
No, night vision, the glare and halos are much less compared to multifocal lens, but definitely they are glare and halos, people do complain, but it's like a monofocal lens.
So definitely even with the extended range of lens also having glare and halo. So just before showing Dr. Tejas' video, I think I personally feel that if the patient from age of 37 to 38 till 52 to 55, my personal view is best option available is press beyond. If you have a slight hinge of doubt, then I think you should opt for either for extended range of IOLs by doing like one eye for perfect emmetropic, rather I'm doing a micromonovision. Or if the patient, like if she's a housewife, doesn't have a night driving problem, and depending upon her overall, even the male patient also who don't have active nightlife, then you can still opt for toric trifocal intraocular lens, which is going to be the very good option. But once again, toric trifocal intraocular lens is a fantastic lens, but once again, price factor, each lens costing almost around, for us, around 75,000 to 80,000, which is a high money. We have to charge the patient around 2-2.5 lakhs both the eye, which is going to be expensive. So if the patient is having cataract, the best available option is either toric trifocal or probably extended range of vision IOLs. That is the best. If patient doesn't have cataract till the age of 55, still we can opt for press beyond. That is the best available option available till date. I think corneal enlace also expensive. That is the reason I think
we stopped doing
corneal enlace, because that is also going to be expensive. And corneal procedure, you need to do a pocket. Last question to Dr. Tejas, by putting this corneal enlace, did you have got any infection in the wound or anything like and one more thing you asked, that even you can do it in the pseudophakic patient.
Yes.
But when you're doing a femto procedure, when you're docking, the eye pressure will increase, shoots up to 60-80. Do you have got any chance that the wound will open and have some problem?
No. I think in femtos now the pressure is about 20-25, number one. Number two, the surgery should have been in at least 6 months before we can actually do this. So there is no question of a wound. Personally, I haven't done many. I have done only probably one. Because like he said, the cost to us comes to around 1.3 lakhs. Then what are we going to charge to the patient?
So yeah, we need to look at the Indian scenario also.
Yeah.
So in the end, we are just concluding with an interesting video from Dr. Tejas Shah. He has got even personal experience with phakic multifocal intraocular. Just
can you switch one minute
video from Dr. Tejas.
A small counseling tip about this halos and glares, because every damn patient who comes to you has gone on the internet and the first thing which pops up is halos and glare. What we try to tell them is that, sir, do you have any halos and glare even right now or when you were young? And most of the patients say yes. And then we ask them, was it very difficult? They said, no, it wasn't very difficult. Well, you might find some more difficulty after a multifocal IOL, but you're going to get used to it. There is a neuroadaptation, and nearly all our patients, I would say almost all patients, have got adapted to it. This also really helps them to understand that, and it does not come as a shock. Haan, pehle bhi halogen glare ho raha hai, abhi thoda badh gaya hai. But well, that's a trade-off, because the patient would have already not been reading good in intermediate, and so it happens. I'll just share the video. This is another option that we can do, is a press biopic fakic IOL. Like I said, a patient is 45 years old, minus 9, and wants to get rid of glasses. Then you can go ahead and relaxing clear lens extraction, or you can also do this. So this is the loading. This is the implantation. This is the IPCL from the care group. You can see there are six holes. Two of them are for positioning to know the right or the wrong place. And this is the final outcome. So this is also one option. And you are very, very sure that if the cataract happens, you can always go ahead and do it. You are not very much worried about a cataract happening in a 45-year-old. So this is the final, this is one of the avenues which also you can explore. And it is not that expensive like a trifocal.
Right.
Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Tejas. We have got 5 minutes for a discussion, because followed by this, I think there is no talk in this hall. So we can little bit, those are having any questions about this press biopic solution, we are ready to take. So any questions from the audience?
KP, one question to Tejas. What about ametropia with presbyopia? Say 45 years old man with the minus 2, minus 3, you can inlays.
With presbyopia?
For inlays, inlays.
Yeah, in fact, there's a inlays were specifically made for ametropes only, right? A person who has never worn glasses is a very, very good candidate, because there are no flaps. It is only a small pocket. And coming to a question of infection, never, because it's only a 5 mm linear cut which seals in, say, 3 hours' time. In fact, I have three of my staff who were my first three patients, and they're still with me. And one of them is our scrub nurse.
Yeah.
So she is also doing all her job. She's 43, and she was a mild hyperopia.
You would have lost 1.5 lakhs from your hand by putting her that corneal inlay stages. So, of course, yes, sir.
Sir, what is the cost?
Yes, sir.
What is the best option for one eye?
Best option for one-eyed patient. If you ask me, one-eyed patient.
What age?
What's
the age of the patient?
What is the age of the patient? Huh? 40. With cataract. See, if one-eyed patient with cataract, or if they are like having a driving and other habit, better to put a monofocal intraocular, not to go with the multifocal eye. You can't. Glare and halos, because one-eyed man, if he develops glare and halo, one more surgery in his eye to expand that IOL is ridiculous. We can't even imagine to do one more surgery in that eye. So rather go with the monofocal and give him the glasses is better.
Sir, what is the cost of presbyopia lenses?
Cost of?
Presbyopia lenses.
LASIK.
Yes.
See, cost actually we charge in our place around 50,000 rupees. And company never charges any additional money on the license. But you need to have the refractive solution from Zeiss, either MEL-80 or MEL-90.
Sir, I have a question. In case of trifocals and the extended region vision IOLs, centration of IOL, is it really important or it's not important?
Chinappa.
And if it is important, are there any personal your methods to ensure that the centration is proper? Apart from the Varion things, which is not available for each and everything. Even Varion is only for the axis, it's not for the centration. How much is centration important, and is there any method to ensure the centration is proper? Both for multifocal as well as the extended range. And one more question, how about putting multifocal in one eye and the extended region vision ERV lenses in the other eye? First question, please.
First question about the centration. Yes.
About the centration, yes, you need to have significantly good centration, considerably good centration, because it works, because the central zone with the near vision add of plus 3.3 is about 3 millimeters. So if that shifts beyond the pupil, definitely it will compromise the near vision. And definitely if that is cutting across the pupil, the amount of glare is a little more. But because of these four haptic design of the trifocal which I was speaking about, getting the centration right is not very challenging. If you have a fairly good Rexis, the centration usually is spot on.
Is there anything, any clinical or practical method to ensure that it is really centered well?
We have a corneal marker for doing your capsular Rexis. You mark on the cornea and just follow the cornea without any parallax.
I want only for the optical zones of the IOL. Rexis, okay.
Even if
the Rexis is centered, it really doesn't ensure that the IOL will be centered very well.
I don't see a reason why the IOL should not be centered, sir. Yeah. Unless the zonules are weak or something like that.
No, he has a very valid point, and this is one of the flip side of a multifocal IOL. So the first suggestion would be that if you really want to do a lot of multifocals, you should be properly, you should have all the instruments for them, like an eye trace or a OPD scan 3 and all that stuff. Number one is you have to find out the angle kappa. Now this angle kappa is very, very important, but then it is very minuscule. It is usually in high hyperopes that the angle kappa is there. But having said that, if you have decided to implant an IOL, there is very, very little that you can do. There have been suggestions that you rotate, you keep it in this axis and this axis, but to me it doesn't work. Once you have committed to implant an IOL and it is right in the center of the bag, there is very little you can do to actually offset. So what practically you can do is, there is always a Purkinje image from the microscope, try to center it. Keep rotating the IOL, and if you see that at this particular position, the IOL is very much in the center of the Purkinje image, go ahead and leave the IOL in that plane. Because we are not sure whether the bag inside is 11 all around or 11 here and 11.7 there, right? So this is the most practical approach. Keep looking at the Purkinje image. You might have to rotate the IOL for about 180 degree to come to that position, and that's it.
So last question to Dr. Vikram Jain. See, he's talking
about... Second question also.
ERV in one eye and the...
No, I have not done ERV lens in the other eye.
Theoretically, what do you think?
No.
Theoretically not possible, practically we have done it.
No, I mean, I don't see a particular reason why we need to do it, because you're putting, giving glare in one eye and no glare in the other.
You might as well put
it in both eyes. Both trifocal in both eyes.
See, there is a situation.
No. Yeah.
A patient got operated with a multifocal IOL in some other place, or when the extended range IOLs were not possible. So would you like to do it because now they are available?
Yeah,
that's the question probably.
With ERVs, you don't have a good near vision.
So right. We can do, no problem.
I think you can try. One of my friends actually has tried this. He has got a series of patients of 100 patients. What he say that one eye with the multifocal and the other eye with the ERV, definitely the intermediate vision also will be better and lesser glare while in the night driving problem. But still, I think...
There is no clear-cut judgment.
No, once again, Tejas, we can always put a Sulcoflex multifocal lens in the other eye. Not that into multifocal lens, and you can put a ERV lens in this eye.
So, question to Dr. Vikram Jain. You're talking about your toric multifocal. Did you see any in your case rotation of these four haptic lenses? Have you dialed any of you in your patients to come across the problem patient after the surgery not at all happy? Or all your patients are like the lenses are stable?
The torics as such are very forgiving. Even up to 10 degrees, you don't have to rotate it. But in a case of a multifocal, you wouldn't want any compromise, and therefore you would align it so perfectly and hope that it never rotates. But with the four haptic lens, the rotational stability and the centration is very good, and I haven't had to rotate it otherwise. But a few
toric monofocals which were even more than 10 degrees away. We didn't rotate it because the patient didn't have any problem. They were toric unifocals, but the toric multifocals were all very well aligned and we didn't have to rotate any.
So any questions from the audience? Yeah.
Does corneal inlay have any effects on corneal indentation while doing non-contact tonometry or applanation tonometry?
No, I think I probably skipped that slide because of time. No, it does not change your applanation readings also, because like I said, it's only 5 microns thin, right? And it is lying at 220 microns depth in the cornea. It doesn't change that. There have been studies also done on that. Because of time, I did not share that. All investigations post inlay remain the same. It is virtually a virgin eye.
Thank you for
one more session.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for all the attendees to part of this session.